Okay, here we have our multivariable function. So that's a function in four-dimensional space. The f of x, y, z equals z minus e to the power x sine power y. This is the point we're interested in, written as a vector, natural log of 3, 3 pi over 2 and negative 3. And if I just asked for the gradient, that will be in the positive x direction, positive y direction, positive z direction, it would be easy. But now I want the partial derivative, or the directional derivative, in this direction, written as a vector 1, 2, 2. Let's remind ourselves of how we're going to do that. Well, we're going to say the derivative in some unit vector direction of f of x, not x, but the vector x, remember that is the gradient of f and x, dot product with that unit vector. So first of all, let's do that. Let's get the gradient of f and x. So what is that going to be? So let's do the first derivative with respect to x of this. Z is a constant, so that's 0. Sine of y is a constant, so that's going to remain, and e to the power x, the derivative of that is e to the power x. It's going to be negative e to the power x sine of y. Now with respect to y, z is still a constant, that's 0. Negative e to the power x is a constant, and okay, just imagine that. Imagine I had minus 3 sine of y. What would be the derivative of that? It's easy. It's negative 3 cosine of y. Okay, so that's all going to stay. Negative e to the power x cosine of y. And lastly, with respect to z, x and y now constant, so that might as well be z minus 3, and the partial the derivative of that would just be 1. Next step, I actually need it at this specific point, P. So now we're interested in this specific point P. Let's get some more chalk. Interested in that specific point P. So the gradient of f at our point is going to be negative e to the power natural log of 3. You've got to know what that is. If I have negative e to the power natural log of 3, you've got to know that that equals just negative 3. So that's going to be minus 3. Oops, times the sine of, what is the sine of 3 pi over 2? You should know that as well, that's negative 1. Come on, again, negative 3 for there, negative 3. What's the cosine of 3 pi over 2? That is 0, comma 1. 1 remains, so what do I have here? I have 3, comma 0, comma 1. 3, comma 0, comma 1. Now, quickly, let's change this into a unit vector. So unit vector E of this vector B is going to be 1, 2, 2 divided by the square root of 1 squared plus 2 squared plus 2 squared. That's the square root of 9. So I'm left here with 1 over square root of 3, comma 2 over square root of 3, comma 2 over square root of 3. So that, and all that is left for me to do, is to get the dot product of these two. So what is that going to be? So that is the directional derivative of f at the point P in that specific direction, v that I was given, is going to be 3 times this, that is 3 over square root of 3, comma, 3 over square root of 3, plus, remember it's a dot product, plus 0 times 2 over square root of 3, 0 times 2 square root of 3 is 0, and 1 times that is plus 1 over square root of 3, that equals 4 over square root of 3, which is that correct? Oh yeah, 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 yeah. Square root of 9 is 3. See how easy it is to make a mistake. 3. 3. Square root of 9 is 3, not square root of 3. So it's 1 over 3, 1 over 3. And that is still 3 times 3, that's 1. Plus a third. 1 plus 1 times 2 thirds. Ooh, lots of stupid arithmetical mistakes, I should say. So So that's 1 plus 2 over 3, and that's 5 over 3. Sorry about that. Do it for yourself. That's 5 over 3. Now, the next question you might get is, in what direction at that point, will we get the maximum rate of change, and in what direction will we get the minimum? So I'm not interested in this anymore. I want to know, in what direction will I get the maximum rate of change, and in what direction minimum? So maximum, I'm talking about the cosine of zero, and minimum, I'm talking cosine of pi, or 180 degrees. Now, how do we do that? Well, let's just look at what the gradient is at that point. We do have that. So the gradient is 3, 0, 1. So let's just look at what the maximum would be, in what direction. Well, I don't know what direction it's called at ABC, but I know that that has got to equal 0. If the dot product is 0, if what happens when the dot product is 0? If I have two vectors, let's say I just use an xy coordinate. You can just remember it very quickly. If I have that vector times that vector, they are at 90 degrees with each other. This vector would be 0, 1. This vector would be 1, 0. If I just made them 1 unit long each, then I get the dot product between those two, and I'll see that the dot product between those two is 0. So they are 90 degrees. They are 90 degrees apart. So if I have something that is 90 degrees apart, this had better give me 0. So I'm left with 3a plus c equals 0. So a equals negative third times c. A equals negative third times c. B, doesn't matter really what b is. Doesn't matter what b is, because b gets multiplied by 0. So that can be anything. And to make life easier for ourselves, let's choose c to be 1. If c equals 1, then a equals negative a third. So if I have negative a third, comma, whatever, let's keep it 0, comma 1. If I look in that direction, if I multiply these two with each other, I'm going to get 0. In other words, this vector points perpendicularly away from the gradient. The gradient that I have there. What I might do is, if I have time, I might do one more problem with these so you can understand where this minimum and maximum values come in. If we look at the norm, though, let me just do that now. If we look at the norm of the gradient of f at p, what are we going to get? Well, remember that it's the gradient of f at p, 3, 0, 1. The norm of that equals square root of 10. 3 times 3 is 9, plus 1 is 10, square root of 10. So square root of 10. And remember we said that it is this norm times the cosine of the angle. So the maximum you're going to get at a cosine of, when can I do that? Remember, so we're going to have this. The gradient of f at p times the cosine of theta. Now, as I said, the maximum is going to be where cosine is where the angle is 0, and if the angle is 0, that's the cosine of 1. So the maximum value, the maximum rate of change that you're ever going to get at that specific point p is going to be the square root of 10. And the minimum that you're ever going to get, obviously, when theta equals 180 degrees or pi, and that's going to be negative square root of 10. So the maximum rate of change at that specific point in this function of ours is square root of 10, and the minimum is going to be negative the square root of 10. Just because cosine goes from positive 1 to negative 1. As promised in the previous video, I just want another example to show you where this cosine comes in, where we use the norm of the gradient. So let's just reiterate, if I want the partial derivative in a certain direction of f at a certain point, it is going to be the gradient of f at that certain point dot product with the unit vector in the direction I'm interested in. So let's look at this. Here we have a multivariable equation. F of x and y equals x squared plus y squared, and we've set that to a third axis here, z. So it's easy to remember. If I have two variables, that means I've got a three-dimensional curve, and it's this three-dimensional parabola. So if we just look at dy z dy y, or dy f dy y, doesn't matter what we wrote, what we write. At a certain point, if I just look at that, what I'm doing is I'm keeping x constant, no matter what. Here we say, for instance, that now the x-axis comes towards you, and I've chosen x equals 0, it doesn't matter what I choose it. I'm going to get this curve in the yz plane. I'm going to get this curve in the yz plane, and at a certain point there's going to be a tangent, at any point, and that's first year calculus. And it will have a certain value at that point. Now, what we are saying with this issue of the maximum and minimum, remember this is going to equal the norm of the gradient at this point times the cosine of the angle, and that's the angle between the direction I'm interested in, which will now not be the y-axis, not z with respect to y in any direction. Okay? If I use that direction as a vector, just as this y-axis here is a vector, then the angle between the gradient at that point and that gives me the same value. I'll get the same answer as I get there if I knew what the angle was between them. And all we now say is if I choose my direction exactly in this direction, so the angle between the gradient, and the direction in which I'm going, if I want that to be maximized, I choose the angle between them to be zero, because the cosine of zero is one, and one times this will give me the maximum value. If I choose directly, if I start traveling in this direction now, I get a maximum rate of increase in first year calculus. If I moved in this direction, I'm going to get a massive, the maximum decrease. Okay, so because 180 degrees, I'm moving that way, now I'm moving 180 degrees in the other direction, I'm going to get zero. So the same goes for multivariable calculus. Okay, so that's going to give me the maximum and the minimum value. Okay. But just think of a three-dimensional spot. Choose any spot on the circumference. Say I choose a day with my tangent now lying there. In which direction must I move to get zero? To get zero change. So I want no change. And it's difficult to extrapolate that from there to here, but if say for instance I moved in this direction, if I moved in this direction, that value doesn't change. If I moved in this direction, there's a rate of change. If I moved in that direction, there's a rate of change. But if I move perpendicularly away from this tangent point there, on this little curve, there's no change. And that is what I meant by, in the previous video where we looked at, say for instance, my point was 3,1, and I get a dot product A,B, that's got to be zero. That's what I meant by that'll be 90 degrees, it comes in with this 90 degrees. If I could move in a certain specific direction, I'm going to get no rate of change. And so this was going to be, in this example, 3a plus b equals 0, so 3a equals negative b, and a equals negative a third b. So whatever I choose, if I choose b to be 1, that means a is negative a third comma 1, that will be a direction, because if I plug this in there now and I do the dot product, I'm going to get zero. So that would then be the direction at this point that I just chose an arbitrary point. Doesn't matter if it's not, doesn't worry about it fitting in there. It actually does, but it doesn't matter. If I have a point that I want to know how to get, in what direction to go to get no change. Okay, if they want the maximum, the question is what direction should I move for max, or what would be the maximum rate of change in this unit vector direction of mine? Just take the norm of this gradient at that point, make this 0 degrees, so that becomes 1, that gives you the maximum. Make this 180 degrees, that gives you negative 1, so it's just going to be, the answer is just going to be positive whatever and negative whatever. That's the minimum and maximum rate of change in this direction. And then if you want to get a direction in which, at this exact same point, in which there'll be no rate of change, just put another vector there, do the dot product. It works well if you just have the 2. And that will give you a rate of a direction that you need to go in. If you go along that vector, there's going to be no rate of change.